Hello, and welcome back to Video Game Archaeology. I'm your host, Dr. Bill Farley. In case this is the first time you're checking in here, I'm a professional archaeologist and a professor of anthropology. I teach courses on archaeology, indigenous studies, museum studies, and anthropological theory. This series of videos is designed to teach many of those same skills, but through the unusual lens of video games. I'm finding tons of interesting ways to think about archaeology and video games side by side, and I'm excited to share them with you. Today, we're going to be talking about one of my favorite recent games, Zelda Breath of the Wild. Breath of the Wild is one of the most important video games of the last decade. It's one of those games you can sink down into and spend literally hundreds of hours with, if you're so inclined. If you've watched my Dark Souls videos, you know that I'm fascinated by a video game's ability to create a sense of place. I think it's one of the most important aspects of what makes a good video game, well, good. In my opinion, Breath of the Wild has a fantastic sense of place. One of the best in video games. This feels like a cohesive world. It's beautiful and complicated, and it feels wonderful to move through. Some of this is because of game mechanics and gameplay elements. Those can be vitally important parts of placemaking in video games. But in Breath of the Wild, I actually think two things make this an exceptional example of place. The landscape, and also the oddball NPCs you can meet in that landscape. This is interesting, because most Zelda games before Breath of the Wild, maybe with the possible exception of Skyward Sword, achieve a sense of place through the use of fantastically designed architecture. There are even nods to this in this game. One of the first places we visit after awakening from our century-long, narratively important slumber with equally narratively important amnesia turns out to be the freaking Temple of Time from Ocarina of Time. Maybe the single most recognizable place in the history of the franchise. In fact, players engage with these early areas, much like archaeologists, with our knowledge of the previous games, particularly Ocarina of Time, as a stand-in for archaeological and historical training. Our nostalgia fills in the blanks for our empty-headed Link. We come upon this courtyard, where our 13-year-old selves once witnessed our first glimpse of Ganondorf. We're excited, we're thrilled. Link is simply confused, his ignorance a useful tool for the game's writers. I want to talk about the landscape and the NPCs, and how this early segment is a little bit of an illusion. How what we think will be a stroll down memory lane turns out to be an immersive simulation in cultural world building. The new intermingles with the old, our nostalgia sense driving us forward to start, acting as our tricycle training wheels and holding our hands to the opening tutorial. After we leave the opening area, though, Breath of the Wild throws us onto a Harley Davidson without the benefit of motorcycle school, releasing us into an absolutely massive world that has very few touchstones to the previous games in the series. That's where Breath of the Wild gets really special, in my opinion. Now, I have a sort of a complicated history with the Zelda series. I played the original when I was a very young child, engaging with the game as only a small child can. I can't remember ever advancing past the first few screens, and yet this beautiful, fantastical little world sparked my imagination. It made me think of the Dark is Rising series by Susan Cooper, particularly The Dark is Rising, the second book in the series. It made me want to go out in the woods and swing a stick around. It inspired me to play other games that would become far more important to me in the near term, and in some cases the long term. Phantasy Star, Shining in the Darkness, Crusader of Senti, and of course Final Fantasy. It was so much better than the Commodore 64 and Atari 2600 games I had played before. And it was a tiny bit more relatable and less a nightmarish postmodern pile of nonsense themes than Super Mario Brothers. Seriously, Super Mario Brothers freaks me out. I did not understand why this Italian man, who looked just a little bit like every one of my Italian-American great uncles, was stuck in this world of monstrous turtles and pipes large enough for a man to slide down, but that apparently served absolutely no sanitary purpose. Those observations distressed me. I was a strange 6-year-old. I borrowed Zelda 2 from my best friend. He had, in turn, stolen it from his older brother to lend to me. I promptly, accidentally deleted his save, and he was very, very mad at me. I played the ever-living heck out of Link to the Past. Every time I played, I got hopelessly lost, somewhere on the overworld, searching for whatever it was I was meant to do next in the game's second half. This, still happens to me now. I have a pretty bad sense of direction. Thanks, Mom. I know that my mom is actually watching this. She's got a terrible sense of direction, and so do I. That's the joke. Hi, Mom. Make sure you hit that like button, Mom. Leave a comment while you're at it. And then I dropped off. I never had an N64 because I was a Squaresoft baby, and I followed Squaresoft wherever they pointed. And in 1997, they were pointing very, very firmly in a particular direction. So that's how I missed Ocarina of Time. Years later, I finally played a borrowed copy in college, but without the power of nostalgia, it was like reading a work of history. I was analyzing the game as a piece of the past, as an influence on the games I loved from years later. There's just this huge, massive, important game that I missed in real time. That disconnect actually makes me feel a lot like how I feel when I'm trying to do archaeology or history. It makes me start to think about how video game lore is not at all that dissimilar from history in the real world. Especially when I'm playing a game like Wind Waker or Breath of the Wild, games that referentially call back to Ocarina. In Wind Waker, this happens quite directly. We're simply told, "Hey buddy, you remember Ocarina of Time? That was a good jam, huh?" I loved those parts of Wind Waker, but they did lack some finesse. In Breath of the Wild, we aren't told anything directly about the connection to Ocarina. Instead, we're shown the connection with environmental storytelling. Oh my god, it's exactly like Dark Souls! We're shown this ruined world, and our imaginations are given rein to fill in the blanks of what has happened between then and now. How many years have passed? How many civilizations have risen and fallen? What if these remains is truly from an era we might recognize from our historical record, the record that constitutes the previous games in the series, and which come from periods we know nothing about? The world here is a palimpsest of archaeological components, civilizations built on top of one another, bleeding into one another, influencing one another. This is beautiful environmental storytelling, and it does at least a fair bit of the work of making this world feel real and lived in. Moments like this one, I think, are the most effective for creating the feeling of a real, lived-in world. I'm walking along some ruined road, potted and pitted from a century of disuse. To either side, there are foundations of buildings, pieces of which have been perhaps removed and reused in the foundations of the houses of the now living. Tools and weapons jut out of the earth, rusty and barely usable, long forgotten and abandoned. And yet, we come upon a merchant who will sell us gems or arrows or fruit. We come across a couple of oddball travelers traveling from one settlement to another. They chat with us, they share their feelings. They barely ever mention the ruins that surround them. This feels beautifully real. This is how the real world works. This is how real people live in relationship with their archaeological landscape. The earth around us has experienced the depth of time. It has housed many people before us, and it gives itself over to our constant reinterpretation. People do not experience this time depth in the same way, tied as we are to our mortal lifespans and the even shorter clockwork of our memories. The people we meet along the road do not find these ruins unusual. They find them comforting. They deem them home. In archaeology, we have a term for people in real life who resemble the folks we meet on the roads. We call them descendant communities. Every person is a living member of a descendant community of one sort or another. We're all linked to our own past and our own heritage through both the real material things with which we interact and the immaterial stories we tell one another and to ourselves. Being a member of a descendant community just means that you have ancestors somewhere to whom you are linked by your knowable ancestry. The myriad ways we connect to these ancestors, or choose not to as the case may be, determine how we link ourselves to the past and to the present. As archaeologists, we tend to focus on the material aspects of these chronological relationships. On the objects we pass from generation to generation, on the buildings we construct knowing they will be lived in by our children and our grandchildren, and by the hills and valleys we walk with the knowledge that they were walked in much the same way by our greatest grandmothers. Practically speaking though, in archaeology we usually use the term descendant community to mean an indigenous group who have some descendancy from the archaeological groups that we study. We are digging up the stuff left behind by, and sometimes the bodies of, real people's ancestors. Archaeologists take this deadly serious. It is the root of probably most of the ethical questions we consider on a daily basis in our work. The most famous case study I can give you to get you thinking about the role of descendant communities in archaeology is Kennewick Man. Kennewick Man is a set of human remains. That's an incredibly clinical, sciencey way of saying Kennewick Man is the skeleton of a person, discovered in 1996 in Washington State. Kennewick Man's bones were radiocarbon dated to around 9,000 years old, making him, at the time, one of the oldest ancestors ever studied by archaeologists. This find set off a firestorm within the archaeological community that in some ways still burns today. It forced an ethical transformation within the science that had massive implications for the science of archaeology and especially for the relationships between archaeologists and indigenous groups. I came of age, academically speaking, during a period when it was taken as gospel that working with and for indigenous groups was a capital G, capital T, good thing. Further, it was then and is now expected that archaeologists engage with descendant communities as a part of their research protocol and as a matter of good ethical practice. This element of the science is called collaborative archaeology for fairly obvious reasons. These considerations were most certainly not always the standard. The history of archaeology and anthropology is arguably one defined by the exploitation of indigenous histories and bodies. The desecration of graves was common practice for generations of archaeologists, and grave goods and human remains were considered among the most valuable archaeological materials for at least the first century of the science. So much so that, by the 1980s, the shelves of museums and universities with archaeological collections were stocked with indigenous remains and the finds associated with them. By the way, if you want a way more in-depth look at this topic, check out the documentary Who Owns the Past. It's getting on in years, but it still does a great job of laying out this history and discussing much of what I'm saying here. Consider it your homework if you like. A campaign led by indigenous groups and their political allies led to a major legal victory in the United States in 1990 with the passing of NAGPRA, or the Native American Grave Protection and Repatriation Act. This law made it illegal to traffic in the sale or exchange of indigenous remains or the objects associated with them. It set up provisions for the accidental disturbance of burials on federal and tribal property, and perhaps most significantly, mandated that any institution with federal funding or permits had to repatriate remains in their collection to the appropriate federally recognized tribal group. Appropriate here means the ones that could most reasonably claim a direct historical linkage to their remains and who had federal recognition. I won't get into the shortcomings of NAGPRA because it's outside the scope of this discussion. Although I'd say the biggest is that it only allows federally recognized tribes to make repatriation claims. There are many state and municipally recognized tribes, and some tribes that have no governmental recognition at all, that might have the most legitimate claim to a set of remains for repatriation, but they do not have any legal recourse to do so under NAGPRA. Problems with the federal recognition process would require an entire video series. Getting back to Kennewick Man, when the remains were first discovered, some of the archaeologists and physical anthropologists who examined them argued that the skeleton had Caucasoid features, or that they more resembled the indigenous people of Japan or Southeast Asia. Media coverage of Kennewick Man added fuel to the fire by featuring an artist's interpretation of what the skeleton might have looked like alive that looked bizarrely like Patrick Stewart. No other representation I've ever seen, and even this representation viewed from other angles, looks anything like a British television actor. West Coast tribes made repatriation claims of Kennewick Man, but were rebuffed by scientists who argued the remains were simply too old to be traceable to any contemporary group, and even argued that Kennewick Man might be from a population living in North America before the arrival of the ancestors of local indigenous people over 10,000 years ago. They didn't actually offer any evidence of that, by the way, just sort of claimed it, so far as I can tell. Those same indigenous communities continued to fight for the right to rebury Kennewick Man, and fought legal battles that lasted literally decades. They eventually lost this battle in the early 2010s. Then, a few years later, genetic research advancements revealed that, in a big shocker, the population that shared by far the most genetic material with Kennewick Man were local indigenous communities. In 2016, Congress actually passed legislation that allowed for the repatriation and reburial of Kennewick Man. The indigenous communities that continued to assert their right to repatriate and rebury Kennewick Man understood that they had an incredibly deep connection to their landscape. It was a matter of course for them that a 9,000-year-old person was their ancestor. That's really incredible if you think about it, that in a world of constant movement and migration, these groups understood that they were connected to those bones in a way that it took scientists nearly 30 years to understand. This type of longevity in a single landscape is certainly not always going to be the case. Most people on this planet move. Migration and immigration are practically a human condition. How many of us have ancestors that traveled by foot or boat or airplane to a new place and a new life? Some of them willingly, others unwillingly. They made homes in these new places while keeping the heritage of where they had been. Humans live this way with the places we find ourselves, and the natural and cultural landscapes of these places are a part of our makeup. In fact, they become a part of our very soul. This brings me full circle to my original thesis for Breath of the Wild. It's a powerful recreation of this reality that makes this game feel lived in. The artists who made this game understood, intimately, the way that human beings relate to their landscape, to their histories, to the places where they are and where they have been. They understood that ancestry and heritage and history are vital parts of the human experience, and they are what make us comfortable in a place. There is an intimacy in the representation of these characters as they move through a ruined world and do not seem to be bothered by its ruin. Link is displaced in time and in memory, and so he stands in for us, the foreign outsider with a tentative visitation status. The people he meets along the roadside remind him of why this place is home.